Good morning and welcome. It's so good to see everyone here today. Thank you so much for coming and welcome to the services. For those of you who are streaming with us this morning, thank you for inviting us into your home. And I hope you enjoy the service today. If you look on the pews that you're sitting on this morning, you'll see an order of worship. You'll also see that song sheets have been provided. Please join in and singing. If you're comfortable with this, we would encourage that. Today, before we begin our service, I want to read from you from the book of Matthew, chapter 11. Read from God's Word together. Matthew 11, verse 28. Come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Let's begin our worship service today.
A thousand times I fell, still your mercy remains. And sure I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. You will above all else, my purpose remains, the art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out.
Testament, if you've been reading along with us, you read through Exodus, and this week we're going to be going through Joshua, and you see an interesting word used over and over again, and that's the word memorial. You'll see there's all sorts of things that God has set up as a memorial. He sets up the Sabbath is a memorial. The breastplate that Aaron wore and the stones that were on it, those were memorials. There's just all Passover itself was a memorial. And there's like the word memorial is used something like 29 times in the first four or five books of the Bible. And it makes you start thinking about what is a memorial. You know, many times cemeteries are referred to as memorial gardens. If you go to a funeral home, sometimes out back, they'll have the area where they have the stones that can be put up, and that it's called a memorials, where you buy a memorial. See, the idea of a memorial is something that causes us to continually remember. And I think the Lord did that for a pretty smart reason. We tend to forget. One of the things that you read when you get in the Old Testament is over and over and over again, we just continually miss the point. We'll start, they'll do good, and then they'll fall away. They'll forget who God is, and God will remind them, something bad will happen. We constantly forget. See, I think Jesus comes along, and he is that memorial for us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul, in explaining the communion to the folks in Corinth, says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" One of the things that's interesting about this is that all the memorials that you see in the Old Testament, and what Jesus is talking about here, is a memorial that is not intended to be done individually. In other words, this is not something that we take by ourselves. We take it in communion with other Christians. It's a memorial that we collectively remember. Now, we've been kind of pressed here the last couple of months because we've had to take it in our living rooms by ourselves. But even then, we've done it as a collective body. And it's important for us to remember that Jesus wants us as a group to remember who he was. Of course, we need to remember individually. But it's this idea of a group, of a body remembering him, that he's wanting us to get when we take communion. So as we take it this morning, remember that although our numbers are a little sparse right now, a lot of folks are joining us from the from their living rooms because of this COVID pandemic that we're dealing with, it is still a collective effort. It's still something that we do together. Would you bow with me as we pray for the bread? Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the many blessings that you give us. Most of all, Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus. Without him, Father, we have no life. No life now, and certainly no life to come. We ask as we take of this bread that you would help bring to our mind the fact that he is the offering for us, that he made this sacrifice, and we're participating in the sacrifice through the shedding of his body and the shedding of his blood. We just ask, Father, that you never let that leave our minds. And, Father, help us to realize the importance of us doing this as a group, Father, that it is the strength that we get from participation in this memorial as well as the strength we get from those of us sitting right next to us. Father, be with us in all that we do. We ask this in the most blessed name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Would you bow as we pray for the through the vine. Our Father in heaven, we come before you again, thinking about the death of your Son. We thank you, Father, this time about the blood that he shed. And Father, we know both medically and metaphorically that life is in the blood. And we know, Father, when he shed his blood, he was shedding his life so that we could have life. Father, that's just a concept that's hard for us. We get it in our heads, but it's hard sometimes to get it in our heart, to realize that you, Father, Lord God Almighty, shared your Son, Lord God Almighty, with us so that we could have eternal life with you. Father, we ask that you'd be with us as we partake of this fruit of the vine. All these things we ask again in the name of your most blessed Son, Jesus. Amen. In the Old Testament, again, one of the interesting ways that the word memorial is used, it's used collectively, like we talked about, as a group and big events like the Passover memorials. But there's an individual component to it as well. And that is that when you brought your sacrifice to the priest to offer, you realize that the priest got a portion of that. The portion that was carved out and put on the altar and burned was referred to as a memorial, a remembrance from you. So when someone brought their offering, there was a component that went to God in the form of the burnt offering part, and then there was a portion that went to the Levites to provide for them in the service that they provided to the rest of the community. That's very much like what we have today in our offering. We are giving to God, but we don't literally give it to God. We don't burn it and let it go up as a sweet-smelling savor like they did in the Old Testament. What we do is we participate in the work that God has laid out for this congregation to do. And that is as much a memorial as the communion that we just took. So as you decide how to support the work of this congregation and other works that you may very well be involved in, we ask that you would do that prayerfully and realizing that that too is a memorial given to us from God. Would you bow with me? Our Father in heaven, thank you for the many blessings that you give us. Father, you have provided us with so much more than we deserve. We ask, Father, as we determine how much to return, that we keep the fact that it is an offering to you and it is an offering for you to the community around us as we do that. Give us generous hearts, Father. All these things we ask in the name of your most blessed Son, Jesus. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail.
give thanks to the Holy One, give thanks, because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One, give thanks, because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son.
His only Son.
Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the sick say, I am whole. Let the bound say, I am free. Because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son.
His only Son.
Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the sick say, I am whole. Let the bound say, I am free. Because of what the Lord has done for us.
Let's all pray together. Father, we're so grateful that we can meet here today as a congregation of believers, of friends, of brothers and sisters, to worship you, Father. We're also grateful, Father, for all those who couldn't make it here today and who might be watching in. We pray, Father, that you would give a blessing to them, as we have by being here together with our friends. Father, you're an awesome God. You're our creator. And we're so thankful for everything that you do for us, for what you've given us. We look around us and we see the evidences of who you are and what you've done. And we're just thankful for that. Father, we pray today that you might strengthen us, that we might show others your kingdom, Father, that the kingdom living that you would have us to do while we're here on earth. We know, Father, that through your Son that this has come about for us to be able to give this to the ones around us. We know, Father, that we have many sick. We have many who are grieving. We pray that you would be with Miss Cindy Ferguson as she grieves the loss of her dad, Jess Perdue. We pray, Father, that you would be with Billy Pettigo as he is recovering from his sickness and in the hospital. We pray that you'd continue to be with Terry Dial as he recovers from COVID-19. We also pray, Father, that you would bless Ty Barnett and his family as through the struggles that he is going through right now. Father, we have many in our own congregation who are having issues. We pray that you would be with Laura Cook, with Miss Ethel Moorhead, with Hillary Vaughn, with Miss Barbara Klein, Miss Viola Drake, A.J. Bennett, Miss Renee Hicks, and Bide Shepherd. As they all go through treatments, Father, and are recovering from surgeries and other things that have happened to them, we just pray that you might cover them with your hand and that you might heal them. Father, we have many events going on today in our world, in our country, that are troubling, We just pray, Father, that as your representatives here on earth, that we might pause and deliberate about how we react to all of these situations. And we pray, Father, that the reactions that we have might be the ones that you would have us to have. We pray, Father, for that guidance through your Spirit and through your Word, that we might act in ways that Christians should act. And we're thankful, Father, for that guidance. Father, sometimes when situations like this occur, and just in our daily lives, we miss the mark that you have shown us. And most times, Father, our conscience tells us that we have. We just pray, Father, that you would forgive us of those transgressions. We pray, Father, that you might again make us wiser, that you might increase your Spirit in us, that we might be able to handle those situations better the next time. And Father, at this time, we also pray that you might keep those issues and those temptations from us, that we might be better Christians and be a better light for those around us in this world. Father, we're so thankful for the Bible that gives us the story of your redemption for mankind, ending, of course, Father, with your Son dying on the cross for us. We're so thankful for Jesus. We're so thankful for the Spirit that you have sent that guides us. And we pray, Father, that as we leave this service today, that you might have us and help us to meditate on those things that you would have us to be and to do. Again, Father, we're thankful for your Son, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
The scripture reading this morning will be taken from John chapter 16, verse 33. I have told you these things, so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world.
The life of Daniel is one of the most unusual biographies in the Bible. Here's a man who spent his entire career, from the time he was a young lad to the time he was an old man, in being in positions of influence and authority. And the whole time we read about this guy, we don't read anything bad. It's the most unusual character. And when we look at hundreds of characters in the Bible, we don't see that about everybody, but we do Daniel. He wasn't perfect, but he was an example of a guy who did well in the long haul. Last week, when we studied about Daniel, we found that he had a godly heritage, and he was a guy that was going to worship the true God his entire life. In Jerusalem, the Babylonians came, and they overtook the place. They took captives, thousands and thousands of God's people, and they took them away to the land of Babylon. And they tried to change everything about God's people, including whom they worshiped and how they worshiped. Last week in Daniel chapter 1, we looked that he was a pretty amazing young man. He was a type of person, along with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that stood head and shoulders above everybody else. He was a person who was apparently athletic. He was a person who was highly intelligent. He was a person that was probably attractive. He excelled in numbers of ways, but one of the things that the Bible says about him was he was smarter 10 times over than anybody else. He proved himself in the area of wisdom. And the same thing could be said about the three young men that were his friends. But when they brought in the king's food and wine to them, they just simply said, "We're not going to do that. We're not going to partake of that." And the big question that was asked that day was, well, why? why will you not do it? And it was because they had training. They remembered what was written in the book of Leviticus chapter 11 about how that the food had to be prepared in a certain way, and how that it would defile them if they ate meat that was offered into idols. The same thing concerning the wine. They could not drink that wine because every time wine was consumed in Babylon, it was in a form of a toast to gods. So in Daniel chapter 1, verse 8, it says that Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, but he asked the chief official not to defile himself this way. So there were four that did this: Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And it was an incredible testimony that they had. And so today, we look at Daniel chapter 3. And consider this question today: how do we fire up our faith? I think this story is incredibly exciting. We're going to read chapter 3 in its entirety, and I hope that you share the same excitement as I do with it. Now, nowhere in Daniel chapter 3 does it refer to Daniel. It does refer to his three friends. Now, we don't know where Daniel was at this particular time. Daniel had been given this particular responsibility of influence, and he might have been traveling for King Nebuchadnezzar. We really don't know. We just know that Daniel wasn't found in this chapter, because I do believe that if Daniel was mentioned in this chapter, he would have been acting the same way that his three other friends were acting, and they'd simply refused to do the commandments of the king. But there are several things I want us to see this morning. First of all, I want you to know that they would not bow. They would not bow. Let's begin with verse 1 in Daniel chapter 3. King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold 90 feet high, 9 feet wide, and set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. He then summoned the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the advisors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the other providential officials to come to the dedication of the image he had set up. So the satraps and the prefects and all these people assembled for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up, and they stood before it. Now, verse 4 tells us about a new character that comes in. This guy was called a herald. He was the guy that made the big announcement. He had a radio voice. Now, that's one of the things I've enjoyed about listening to Jeff's one-minute devotionals, is he has a good radio voice. Have you noticed that? He does. I want to brag on him a little bit. He's easy to listen to. Everybody doesn't have a good radio voice. But here is this herald. And he was an orator. And he could speak to where everybody listened. And so he proclaimed. He said, "This is what I command you to do, O peoples, nations, and men of every language. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harps, the pipes, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace." I wonder if they anticipated those that wasn't going to fall down and worship. I mean, why else would they have this big fire going? But then I love verse 7. You know, as soon as they heard the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, and all kinds of music, all the peoples, nations, and men of every language fell down and worshiped the image that Nebuchadnezzar has set up. I think there's some things we need to remember about this old king. First of all, he'd been a general. He'd been a general for about 40 years, a good one. We do not recall that he ever lost a battle. He had won all his battles. So he was the top of the line, and he was pretty good at that. And so here we are, we're at Babylon, we're at center stage, we're at the center of idolatry, and just imagine the scene. There are idols everywhere. Everywhere you turn, there are idols everywhere. And so now, he commands that one be built, 90 foot tall, 6 foot wide, and they go out to this plain, and they set it out there. And this one is going to be better than any graven image anywhere else in Babylon. And now he says, when you hear my music, you get down and worship. Well, you know, when we assembled this morning, I don't remember anybody coming in the back door with a whip and cracking a whip and saying, okay, now you're going to worship. You understand what I'm saying? Now, and if you don't, I've got a fire built out here, and we're going to take care of you. They didn't threaten us in any capacity this morning. We had the free will to come and to worship by choice. But then look at verse 8. At this time, some astrologers came forward and denounced the Jews. Now get the false flattery that these guys said. It just amazes me, the people that want to get attention, what they do to get attention. And so they go to the king, and now they're going to spread butter on it. I mean, they're going to make this, oh, king, may you live forever. Just read how many times they say that to him, to flatter him, to butter him up. Oh, king, may you just live forever. You've issued a decree, O king, that everyone who hears the sound, and notice how many times they mention the instruments that's played. They're so proud of this. They're so happy with all this music they're making. But he says, who hears the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipes, and all kinds of music, fall down and worship the image of gold. And that whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into a blazing furnace. But there are some Jews. Did you hear that? But there are some Jews who did not bow down, whom you've had affairs over the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these are some guys that work for you, king, who pay no attention to you, O king. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold that you have set up. Now, I don't know anything about these guys that tattletale, but they sort of remind me of Eddie Haskell. You remember him? Now, if you do, then it definitely tells our age. And if you don't have a clue who Eddie was, it definitely tells your age. And, you know, I just read last week that he passed away, just for a little information there. But I just think of these guys being Eddie. Just can't wait to come and tell on Beaver. Poor little old Beaver. Everything that he did, Eddie was going to come and tattletale on the little guy. Well, now you've got these guys. Hey, did you know you've got these Jews? And, man, when you played that good music, man, was it good. I just really love this music. They didn't bow down to you. They didn't worship this God. And isn't it always interesting to notice how somebody talks around a king? We see this on the news media today. People that are prominent and influenced, why it completely changes their personality when they get around these guys. Well, we see what happened here. I think these guys were working around Nebuchadnezzar, and all of a sudden they get word that these guys didn't bow down and worship this God. And they just couldn't wait to get back. And they start in, oh, king, live forever. But there's three guys whom you know because you placed in this province to take care of your territory. They did not bow and worship you. Well, something else I want you to notice this morning, too, is they did not bend. Not only did they not bow, but they did not bend from what they believed in. And they weren't. They weren't ever going to do that. Well, what was the king's response to this? What did old Nebuchadnezzar do? Look at verse 13. The Bible says, furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and some of these men brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the idol of gold I have set up? Now, when you hear the sound of, and then he goes through the whole list again, all the instruments that he's so proud of. And if you're ready to fall down and worship, then very good. In other words, he's saying, it's just probably a mistake on your part. I mean, you didn't hear the music, or maybe you didn't get the beat. It was on 4/4 time, and you just didn't fall down when the beat was there or something. Surely, you just made a mistake. But then he says, but if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? So notice what his response was. His first response was anger. He got mad. The Bible says he was furious. And as we see the opening chapters of the book of Daniel, he had no control over his emotions. The first two chapters that we've studied thus far, he had no control of his emotions. It didn't change for us in chapter 3. He had a godless mold that he wanted to squeeze the Hebrew people into. And so, when they resisted, he was furious. He was angry. And you know, the same thing can happen to us today. When the world wants us to go along with things, its fashions, its fads, its political correctness, they want us to be like everyone else. They want to mold us just like Nebuchadnezzar wanted to mold the Hebrews then. The world wants to mold us today into their way of thinking. But the book of John, 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 says, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not with him. And folks, we're going to see people that will get angry with us. They will. But the second attitude I want us to see that the king had was that of amazement. He said to them, is it true? Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you will not serve my gods or worship the image of gold that I set up? Now, isn't that sort of a condescending question? Is it true? You know, all the way back to the book of Genesis, when we read that when Satan was in front of Eve, he used the same tactic. Is it true that you'll be as smart as? Well, look what Nebuchadnezzar's doing here. And apparently he wasn't aware of the commandments of having no other gods before me, or the second commandment that says do not make any graven image at all. But he wasn't aware of that. He didn't care. And then look at the antagonism that went for this. Look at that attitude that was displayed here. Look at verse 15. Now when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipes, and all kinds of music, and if you're ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Listen to the sarcasm that comes next. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? You see the progression that takes place here? He starts with diplomacy. Surely, you just forgot. Sure, you didn't read the rule. You didn't get the email. You didn't get the text about this. Surely, you just missed this. And then he changes. He becomes angry. And then what I want us to see next, how did these guys respond? What did Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego do? Look again at verse 16, and let's see the response of these guys. You know, it's almost like I wish we didn't know the end of the story already. Because since we know the end of the story, we know exactly, you know, what they were thinking. But I think this is incredible. The first thing we're going to see is courage. These guys had all kinds of courage. Look at verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. Now, how brave was that? to stand before somebody that can say, we're going to throw you in the fire. Do you not understand? I'm going to throw you in the fire. Do you not get it? Man, you're going to die. And they very calmly said, we do not need to defend ourselves before you this day. We've already made up our minds. And if we're thrown into the blazing furnace, the scripture says, the God we serve is able to save us from it. He will rescue us from your hand, O King. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O King, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. I can't hardly read this without getting a lump in my throat. I can't hardly read this without the hair standing up in my arm. I mean, you're talking about courage. You're talking about being brave. And that's the only three we read about. All the other Hebrew boys that were supposed to be smart and everything, we didn't hear anything from them. But we did these three guys. And I believe they made their mind up earlier. Just like when they were challenged to eat food that wasn't presentable and drink the wine that was dedicated to gods. They made decisions in smaller things, and now when this big decision took place, they already had their minds up what they were going to do, and they simply were not going to obey it. Jesus said, if you're faithful in small things, I'll put you in charge of many things. And you'll never make the big decision of the fiery furnace if you hadn't made little decisions before we get there. And that's what they did. Notice, too, they had a great deal of confidence. You know, we sing the song, trust and obey all the time when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word. Trust and obey. And so we've got to make decisions along the way, and they'd been doing that. They had the confidence to tell Nebuchadnezzar, no, we're not going to do this. And if it means the furnace, it just means the furnace, but we're not going to take place in this. And notice, too, the commitment that they made. They said, you know, our God is able to save us if he chooses to. But if he chooses not to, guess what, King? We're not going to do it. We're not going to serve him. We're not going to worship that God made with hands. We're not going to worship that golden idol. And basically what they were saying is, regardless of your furnace, regardless of how hot it is, we have hope. And what an incredible testimony. Even if he chooses not to save us, we're still not going to bow down and worship you. Isn't that awesome? And notice with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, there was no second plea. They didn't say, oh man, I didn't understand the instructions. I really don't want to die. Please give me a second chance. Oh, please, oh, please. They didn't do that. There was no plea for a second chance. Next time, King, we'll bow down, I promise. They didn't do that. Can we pray like that when we're looking for a job and it seems the door keeps slamming in our face? Lord, if it's right for me, just let me have it. If it's not, I'm going to trust in you. When a relative of yours gets cancer, can you say with these guys, our God is able to save him or her, but if he doesn't, if he chooses not to, we're going to serve him, we're going to worship him, we're going to turn our lives over to God. I like what Jerry Bynes says. He says, sometimes God delivers us out of the fire, and sometimes he delivers us through the fire. Now notice, they would not burn. They would not. Look at verse 19. Then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and his attitude toward them changed. And he ordered the furnace heated seven times hotter than usual, and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent, and the furnace was so hot, that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and these three men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing service. So, what did they experience? Well, they experienced persecution. Persecution. The fire was hot already, but he gave an order that it's seven times hotter than it was. Now, I don't know why he needed to do that. It doesn't take much of a fire to kill somebody. But yet, you know, he was angry. He was out of control. He's basically saying, I'm going to teach you a lesson and everybody else that doesn't bow down to the God that I've built. Your guys are going to be toast in a few minutes. I want them thrown in the fire. I want them thrown in the fire right now. We're going to have a celebration, you understand? And just because you don't bow down to the God when I play my music, man, was he angry? Just think about the persecution that goes on. And you know, if we're sincere about our faith, persecution is going to hit us. In the book of Timothy, chapter 3, verse 12, it says, in fact, anyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Secondly, they also experienced preservation. Look at verse 24. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, weren't there three men that we tied up and threw into the fire? Can you imagine? He hops up. Weren't there three? Now they're having a party. And can you not see the tattletale, the guys that did the tattling? Oh, King, live forever. Now they're looking in there and they're going, yeah, you're right. There's four. Verse 25 said, look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound, unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of the gods. Can you imagine this? They think everything's over. They think everything's great. They're celebrating, and then all of a sudden, the king's face turns white, and he looks in there and he says, man, did we just throw three guys in? Why is there four? Why is there four? Look at verse 26. Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out. Come out. Now, I don't know about you, but I might have had a tendency here to say, I can't hear you, King. Could you come a little closer? I didn't hear you. Could you come a little closer to the fire, please? But they didn't do that. So he shouts out. Look what he shouted. Servants of the Most High God, come out. So they came out. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their head singed. Their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. You can say, wow, what a miracle. What a miracle. I like what John Barnes says. The Lord Jesus in heaven stepped off his throne, descended the staircase to earth, assumed human form, opened the door of the furnace, and said to the fire, cool it, and turn down the thermostat. Amazing. Notice, too, that they experienced promotion. Verse 28, then Nebuchadnezzar said, praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has set his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than to serve or worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I decree and get ready. He's changing the whole law just because of these three guys. I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything about the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces and their houses be turned into piles of rubble. That must be a something he likes, because that's what we heard in chapter 1. Cut them into pieces, have their houses turned into rubble. And so then he promoted them. And so he made it a law. The dudes are promoted, and the king's now happy. So, what are our lessons from this story for today's times? What can we learn from Daniel chapter 3 that we can apply today? First thing I want us to see is to expect heat. Jesus said in John chapter 16, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you'll have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Warren Wiersbe says, when God permits his children to go through the furnace, he keeps his eye on the clock and his hand on the thermostat. Also, exercise faith. Why are we here today? Why did you come? Faith. I can't even keep up with my mask. I was going to show. You know, we're in here and we're all putting these on. I mean, it takes a great deal of faith, does it not? I mean, we're exercising our faith by coming. And yes, things are different. I don't like singing through a mask. I don't like sitting this far apart. I hate the elbow bumps. I hate the waves, the winks. I want to shake somebody's hand. I want to hug somebody. You know, I miss all that. I'm ready to go out and eat with you. That kind of thing. But we have to exercise faith. That's what they did here. And then, exalt the Lord. Stay faithful to him. It may cost you some friends. It may cost you a job. It might cost you a promotion. It might cost you a relationship with your family. I like what James Dobson says in his book that he wrote, When God Doesn't Make Sense. He writes, it is so comforting to note that only Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire. That other man, whom we believe to have been Christ, remained there to comfort and protect you and me when we go through the fiery trails. And he's right. Jesus will be there, and he'll be there for us. So in this story this morning, what is your idol? What is your life? You know, we get so centered around sports teams. If there's anything this COVID-19 has taught us is that we can make it without professional sports. We don't have anybody to idolize. We can live without all of that. Is it a hobby? Is it a relationship? Is it a possession? Is it the pursuit of money? And it's probably not a 90-foot idol that's 6 foot wide, but it's something. So what is your fiery furnace? I guarantee you that if you've committed your life to Jesus Christ, you're going to find yourself in the fiery furnace. And also, if you haven't, I believe that fire needs to rekindle your spirit today. And whether you're here this morning or whether or not you're watching us on the live stream, I do hope that a fire is lit under you if you need to respond to Jesus Christ. And if you've never confessed the name of Jesus, I hope that fire is ignited and will cause you to move. You know, last week we talked about making haste, to hurry up. Well, today I hope the fire is burning within you and you're ready to repent. And if you've been going down that road of sin and you need to repent from that and turn and go in the opposite direction, I hope that fire causes you to do that. And if you're needing to be buried with him in baptism, I hope that you'll do that so that your name will be added to the Lamb's Book of Life, that you'll receive the forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. I hope that fire will cause you to respond. And I hope that we remember the words that we read from the very beginning today from the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 28, that says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. You'll find rest unto your soul." Rest, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So if we can help you this morning to get out of that fire and become a child of God, this song makes it convenient for you who are here this morning to respond. And for those of you who are watching us over the live stream, please call me. Call the church. Call Stephen. Call Eli. Call one of our elders. We'll be glad to help you in any way. And we bid you to come now. Let's all stand together.
Faithful love flowing down from the thorn-covered crown makes me whole, saves my soul, washes whiter than snow. Faithful love calms each fear, reaches down, dries each tear, holds my hand when I can't stand on my own. Faithful love from above came to earth to show the Father's love, and I'll Jesus is his name. Faithful love is a friend, just when hope seems to end. Welcome face, sweet embrace, tender touch filled with grace. Faithful love, endless power, living flame, spirit's fire, burning bright in the night, guiding my way. Faithful love, from above, came to earth to show the Father's love, and I'll Jesus is his name, for I've seen faithful love face to face, and Jesus is his name.
Good to see everyone here again today, and thank you for joining us on Facebook Live. It will be up on YouTube later this afternoon as well. For those of you that want to go back and watch. Just a couple of announcements. We are starting to redo the Pathfinder every week. That'll be happening, just started this week. So it's on the website. Just check out all the news and information. And as we gain more momentum to going back to the new normal, we're hoping to put more announcements in there, update you on some things that have been canceled and postponed, and maybe when they'll be rescheduled in the future. The next big thing for our youth group and for all those that really love church camp, we will be missing church camp next week. We should be preparing and packing and getting ready to go to church camp next Sunday, the 21st. However, we're going to do a virtual church camp. Eli and I are actually going over to film today and have some stuff ready, and it will be posted on the Simpson County Youth Camp Facebook page next Sunday at 4:30. For some big announcements about church camp coming to you virtually later this summer. Thank you again for being with us. Please continue all those on a prayer list. We'll keep the Codaphone updated, the website updated, and check out everything also on Facebook. Would you bow with me, please? Thank you, dear Father, for us gathering again today, and we thank you so much for all those here in attendance here at the building and keeping us safe and letting us be smart during these times. Dear Father, thank you again for our services today, and we hope they were a blessing to you and all those here in attendance in our building and also virtually with us online. Continue to be with all those that Jeff mentioned in our prayer list and all those others that are on our prayer list, and just keep them and watch over them. And dear Father, especially be with them and their families during this time and give them the strength that they need to endure the pains that they're going through. We ask and pray that you be with those that have recently lost loved ones here in our community, and just help them during their tragic times and other times of losing a loved one, and just helping them draw closer to you. And let us help to do our best to reach out to them in the best possible way. Please be with our brothers and sisters in Christ the world over that are meeting in different locations in the States and abroad, and just be with them as they're also enduring some of the things that we are, and gathering back in their churches and regathering their flock, and just letting them be the best missionaries that they can be in their communities and in their areas. Let us go out and spread thy word and do the best that we can to bring others closer to you. Let us continue to grow our faith and show the faith just like these three young men did in the book of Daniel, and how they endured all that they went through, because, dear Father, we can do the same in our lifetime here upon in your kingdom here on earth. Let us go and be smart. Let us go and be a pillar for you, and we thank you for your son died upon the cross. His name we pray. Amen.